The second day of the third International Hopeful Conference held in Punta Cana, Dominican Republic, centered around the sharing of experiences and best practices in disaster management.
Risk and disaster management has become increasingly more significant, and today it is considered to be a cross-cutting axis for sustainable development and the safety of our populations.
In Chile, we hit the lotto. We have them all. The only threat that we don't have are hurricanes up to this moment.
We almost have 278,000 people who are still living in camps. We are continuing to extend the network of civil protection in order to complete the local committees and complement their help.
Over the course of several workshops, panelists from Haiti, Chile, Turkey, Colombia, Mexico, Cuba, and overarching agencies like the Caribbean Disaster Emergency Management Agency and the Central American Center for the Coordination of Disaster Prevention laid out the lessons they learned from the process of managing the aftermath of hurricanes, landslides, floods, earthquakes, and other natural catastrophes.
Some lessons learned and or observed. The first one is that the CDRO kit and equipment need regular updating and enhancement. Second is that the training needs to be more practical and for longer periods.
It is important that along its history, the armed forces, along their history, have always had a involvement, participation in all national emergencies mainly, and that experience of operation, of life history, is what allowed us on the day of the earthquake tsunami to be able to operate in coordination with all the elements that make up the civil protection system.
For the government of the President of Mexico, as of May, it was the first time when the National Civil Protection Council was established, which provided the new guidelines related to civil protection, the first of which is to increase the fund for disaster prevention even more than for responding to disasters.
Panelists also focused on aid that goes beyond the basic needs of shelter, water, and food, faced by many victims of nature's violence, needs that are often addressed weeks or even months after a disaster strikes, but are no less relevant to the process of recovery in affected areas.
These survivors, you also know very well that they are traumatized. They might not be affected physically, but they are very much traumatized, so they need psychological help. And that is the reason why on the field we had 200 psychologists working with these traumatized survivors.
We come in and we actually confine the survivors, and we turn them into refugees, and we confine them in special places and tell them, do not move, stay put, we will provide for you. And disasters do not create refugees. Disasters create survivors. It is the conventional relief system that actually turns the survivors into refugees.
The two-day conference ended with the publication of an outcome document which underscored the important role of the Hope For Initiative to strengthen the efforts of preserving lives through effective civil-military coordination.
This international conference is the beginning of a national and regional dialogue with all participants to translate the choices of the Hope For Initiative and the result of the recommendations of the three conferences to real steps.
We have heard a number of presentations recognizing that Hope For Initiative is not only necessary and should continue further, but should be expanded both in terms of its membership as well as in terms of its conceptual guidelines.
It also celebrated the extraordinary disaster management capacity and capability that many countries displayed in the past, and encouraged the participants to keep sharing best practices in emergency response.
It has been evidence that there's a need to continue strengthening cooperation amongst participating nations with the purpose of overcoming the weaknesses identified in civilian-military coordination that must be supported by the added value of the armed forces.
We were encouraged because we saw that countries really want to come together and share their experiences in the most transparent, open, and sincere fashion possible.
I see the merit of having a Hope For here, and by organizing the event like this, inviting some countries, and it will give some more knowledge and capacity to countries who are attending this conference to build on their capacity, you know, based on what has been discussed within the Hope For conference.
Organizers and participants looked at the future for the Hope For initiative beyond 2013, towards the establishment of several centers of excellence for training and research, an intensified collaboration with the United Nations Office for Humanitarian Affairs, and a technical expert meeting to be held in New York in 2014.
The next step there will be a meeting of a high-level commission to decide the roadmap for the forthcoming years. And of course, each one of the region will develop their own plan of action.
Esta conferencia tiene el valor añadido de que más de 50 estados y organizaciones presentes han manifestado el interés y el compromiso de sumarse a la iniciativa para contribuir a crear mecanismos estandarizados regionales.
I think this is gonna kind of like get into another stage and will involve risk reduction and will involve disaster management areas as well. So it's gonna have more countries and it's gonna have more context conceptually.
As the third International Hope For conference came to an end, participants walked away with a new sense of commitment to facilitate a more thorough and intense cooperation between military and civil disaster relief efforts. And to make local, regional, and global emergency relief aid more effective, facing upcoming natural threats head-on and making the world a safer place for all. This is Shari Naiman, reporting from Punta Cana, Dominican Republic, for South-South News.